Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
Pledge of Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, and now I turn it over for recognition to Sandy.
Yes. This evening we have our fall athletics presentations, and with us this evening to start us out, Stephanie DeVos, Hudson Schools Athletic Director.
Good evening. Thank you for having us. I was just telling the couple guys in the back that it's hard to believe that fall's over, winter's here, and we have no snow. And just to add to that, I put up a snowman because it's going to snow on Saturday. So if I have glitter all over me, that's why I have glitter. I'm going to introduce the three AMP kids, our athletes making progress. They are new leaders this year, so please welcome the three of them, and I'll let them take over and help them along.
So we're all part of AMP, and I'm Spencer.
I'm Logan.
Logan Nelson.
I'm Sophia Westerman.
And the main goal of this club is to teach leadership among student athletes, which they can carry with them to their season, which it believes will create successful seasons among all sports. So that's pretty much what we're targeting this year.
So with that, we are going to get into the athletic programs that we went through this fall, and I hope you like our presentation.
We just want to congratulate all the seniors who had the top GPAs in their sport and take a moment to also congratulate all the coaches on their great seasons that we've had this fall. Starting off, well, I'm Sophia, I'm from the Raiders dance team as well, and along with us and the cheer squad, the fall cheer and stunt team, we both led crowds roaring victories at the football games. We enjoyed cheering, loved halftime shows, loved watching the football guys go out to victory and helping keep Hudson nice and loud and proud.
All right, and next we have the football team coached by Adam Cowles. We had a great year this year. I'm also part of the football team. We spent many long hours on the road this year on our way to an 8-3 record, 5-2 in the conference, and we tied for second place and earned a spot in the playoffs, winning our level one playoff game against Chippewa Falls. And with that, I would like to introduce our captains of the football team.
Come on up, you guys. Coach.
All right, so as Logan said, I'm one of the captains, Spencer Schmidt, so you guys already know that.
I'm another captain. I'm Jake Danielson.
I'm Bryce Marion.
And I'm Dominic Sitabeco.
So as Logan stated, we finished 8-3, 5-2 in conference, which put us tied for second. We earned a spot in the playoffs, and we faced Chippewa, another conference team. We ended up beating them. We had second round and losing to Stevens Point. Overall, it's a very successful rebound off of last year's 6-2 season. I'm sure you guys all know. And this year is pretty awesome with the coaches backing us and everything. The mentality of all the players was completely geared up to win. And that helped us defeat Heartland Arrowhead second round, which was a big momentum swing for all of us.
Fantastic.
Really got everybody going. And it really filled the community with belief with us, which helps more than anything. So it's a great rebound to continue the legacy and start carrying that torch again. We are football.
Coach Kells is too shy to talk. But I just want to, this was one team, and I've been involved with athletics for 40 years, and I just want to give kudos to this team for the heart that they had, and the just like they said, the belief that they made everybody in this community believe, and it is one of the most awesome, funnest years for football that I have ever experienced, and I know everybody else did. So, great job, guys.
The next sport we would like to introduce would be girls golf. They consistently placed third in BRC meets. They traveled to Superior to compete in regionals, where they play 6 out of 9 teams. Leading the Raiders this year was senior Lexi Jonas, who is committed to Sioux Falls, and she was an individual sectional champ herself, which was pretty good. She had a very consistently successful season again.
And Lexi finished 19th.
And she also finished 19th at state. There you go. And they are coached by Brian Burbach.
Up next, we have the boys' soccer team.
Okay, hold on. Boys' soccer team, come on up.
On the whole game. Okay, I'm one of the four captains for the boys' soccer team. The other three are Chase Blackman, Willie Douglas, and Dylan Ferreira, and they couldn't be here, I guess. So our season, boys' soccer, always does pretty well, but this year we actually went undefeated in conference, went 12-0, finally beat those old Aves, so that was good. And I guess I'd give some of our successes this season, I'd give it to our coach, Solom. He really gave us a good opportunity to like have difficult teams in our schedule. We played Stillwater at the beginning of the year, and if you don't know, they won state over in Minnesota. So just like really good competition throughout the year made us better. And I guess there wasn't actually that much like high expectations for us because we lost three like great athletes in Dan Klunt, Will Richards, and Peyton Spencer. And so expectations were a little low for us this year, but I think we did well.
What was the score of the Stillwater game?
Stillwater game was 2-0 them. So, and actually, they lost to Wayzata in the championship 2-0. So technically, we were in the state championship. That's about it.
Thank you.
Yeah.
All right, up next, we have girls swim and dive. This team, they went on and became the conference champs for the fourth consecutive year, and they hosted the sectional meet where they cheered on by many fans, and they became the sectional champs, qualifying a list of 9 girls for the tournament, and just we want to congratulate them on a successful season and welcome them.
Hi, I'm Abby Zappa. I'm one of 3 captains for the girls swim dive team. We have Hannah Erickson and then Jenna Stanzi as well. We were undefeated for all of our dual meets, and then we were conference and sectional champs, and conference was our 4th year winning in a row. And then we had 9 girls go to state. This is our head coach, Maggie Hill.
I look a little dazed because we just got back from state yesterday. So, but the girls were fantastic. They are terrific athletes, and they did a great job this year having been in a routine and had the same coach for many years, so they did a great job adapting and working through that, obviously, and continuing the winning tradition.
Thank you.
The next fall sport we have is girls tennis. They had a BRC record of 4-2, an overall record of 14-6, and they had a very successful season. This girls golf here. I mean tennis. I bet tennis. Nope. Alright. So I'll just go on. Hudson qualified 7 of their 10 varsity starters in sectionals, which is very, very, very well. Then Sammy and Anna won their first state match defeating Wanakee by 2 straight sets, which is very dominant. Eventually coming up short in the second round, but they still had a great season as an entire sport.
They also had a new coach this year, John Knutson, so that was pretty cool. But they did so well. Next we have girls volleyball. You want to come up here?
Coach.
I'm Julia Bennett, and this is Ellie Draper, Remy Goplair, and Kylie Christensen. We started our season off kind of rough with a lot of injuries, but we were able to adjust well to unfamiliar lineups and then progress better as the year went on. Being put in different positions created a lot of character in our team, and we were a very tight-knit team, and we didn't have like any conflict at all. And we were blessed with 2 managers. One was an injured senior who was unable to try out, and the other was a sophomore girl who was a special needs kid.
We ended our season winning. We won our home tournament, I think the fifth or sixth year, and then we won the Northwestern tournament, which we've only won two times, and the last time was 6 years ago, so that was a pretty big deal. We also placed pretty high in the Mora tournament, and we ended with three people being on the all-conference. So Kylie got first-team all-conference as a senior, Shelby Blank as a senior got second-team all-conference, and Evie Draper got honorable mention as a sophomore. So it was a pretty great year.
Congratulations.
All right, next up we have boys cross country, where this team, they finished and competed, and they ended up winning the conference and sectional championships, and then they went on to compete in state. And they also had several runners who went and competed in the state running tournament and also did very well. So we would like to welcome up the captains for that sport.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We are three of four captains. I'm George.
I'm Connor Gaffin.
I'm Kyle Russ. And our season started off really early on in June because any cross-country team is not built in a day, so we began our season in June training really hard with captain practice. He was running a lot of those summer miles to start getting us ready for when the fall season came around and getting us ready to win those conference and sectional championships.
Yeah, then we moved on to the season, and we really didn't run our full varsity until the end of the season, just resting people and getting ready for the big meets at the end. And that's when we really started dominating and winning all of the meets up until conference. And then we won conference, JV, and varsity. And then moved on to sectionals and won sectionals and went to state.
Throughout the season, we've just been dominant. And as we said, we've been winning pretty much every single meet. Then they went to state, and I was unfortunately unable to run at state. Me and Kyle were unable to. But the team went with a very strong yet young team. George was the only senior on the team. Had a lot of up-and-coming freshmen and sophomores. And it was just incredible to see them run. And they finished off fourth in the state, which is a huge improvement from last year when we ran and we got 11th place. So looking forward to next year.
To the WIA, we did not start in June. Okay, captain's practice. And I would like to introduce Coach Don Krupa. Don, would you stand up? I believe this is his 48th year.
Yes. Wow.
48 years, so congratulations, Don. He's going for that state tournament run next year.
The next sport I'd like to introduce is girls cross country, who had a very successful season, so you guys would like to come up.
I'm Sarah Miller.
I'm Emmy Farrago.
Well, we started our season in June with captain's practice, just building our miles pretty much and kind of like team bonding. We had a new coach this year. His name is Jeremy. It was a pretty drastic change from last year, but we adapted pretty well, and he led us to some success. We had a pretty young team this year, just three seniors, me, Emmy, and Lauren Eichel. Other than that, it was all freshmen and sophomores, and they did really good this year, so.
Yeah, we had, like, a really young team this year. Like, our top three runners on the team were two freshmen and a sophomore, so that was really impressive. And then at sectionals this year, we got third, where last year we got sixth, so we definitely moved up this year with a really young team, so, like, looking forward to next year. And sectionals, they take the top two teams, and we were in the running mostly with Memorial and Menominee, and we didn't quite make it, but we had a freshman make it as an individual, and at this state tournament, she got 15th out of, like, 190 runners, so it was really impressive for a freshman. That was a good end of the year.
In closing, we just want to let you all know that a total of 513 athletes participated in our fall sport programs this year, 279 being male and 234 being female. So it was an awesome fall season for Hudson, and sure, everybody can't wait till next year. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Any comments or questions from board members?
Sue? Mr. President, I would like to just comment on something that resonated with me with the volleyball group when they talked about that character building by playing different position, and it just positions, and it kind of just struck me that sort of has a nice mantra for just life in general, because it's, you know, sometimes we defer to playing what we know we can do well. Anyway, I like that.
Ms. President?
Rob?
You know, it never ceases to amaze me, you know, what all you students do, you know, the attention to your studies, just the success and the domination that that we have as a school. Very, very proud. You know, I was at the football banquet last night, you know, talked a lot about the theme for the season, the football season, Anchors Up, and across the board, and I don't know if everybody's familiar with that theme, but overcome adversity, you know, strive as a team, and we're striving as a district, you know, so kudos to everybody.
Yes. Any other questions or comments? I just want to say also thank you to all the students who participated, and I was really struck by a few things. First, and great job, you three presenters from AMP. We like to see that kind of leadership among our students, but one is the appreciation for the coaches. You guys know that those coaches put their heart and soul into it. This is not something they're doing for big bucks or big pay. It's, I don't know what it would work out to per hour that they're thinking and doing with regard to their coaching. But also I like the fact that you guys recognize the part of the being a student and, you know, the people who get the good GPAs. And I know that it's something Coach Collins and the other coaches have always looked and strove to make that point, is that you need to, this is, you are student athletes, you know, and first. And then finally, the idea of success or improvement is not just necessarily judged by, you know, whether you go to state or how high you finish at state or whatever, but how'd you do 1 year over the other? How'd you do compared to the beginning of the season to the end of the season? And in the end, did you always try your best? And I saw that in a lot of different sports, and makes me the most proud to be on the school board when we see everyone striving for excellence. So great job. All right, next up, a little segue while folks who might not be staying for the whole meeting, if they wish to leave. Citizens request to speak about non-action items. Do we have anything, Mr. Secretary? All right. No request to speak on non-action items. Then that leads us to the superintendent's report. And Dr. Ouellette, starting off, looks like state convention you want to mention.
Thank you, Jamie. The state convention is coming up in January. I believe Tim emailed board members for an RSVP. We have reserved rooms and things along those lines, but we do need to finalize that list so we can either release rooms we don't need or and then also get people actually signed up for the conference. So if you have not emailed him back yet, please let him know. It is a good conference, a lot of great things going on. It's great to be able to see what's going on around the state, what other districts and challenges that they're facing, and a lot of really great breakout sessions. I know Jamie's gone before. Rob and Bruce went last year. I don't know if you have any comments about it, last year's experience or?
Sure, Mr. President.
Yeah.
You know, it's a great opportunity to talk with other school board members, understand what they're dealing with, and, you know, understand that we're not in this by ourselves by any stretch. There's a lot of really creative ideas out in the state, and I got a lot out of the camaraderie in the sessions.
Yeah, I echo that. I think the sessions themselves, they seem to have a theme that a number of the districts were focused on. So, you know, whether it was, you know, driving, you know, community activities or getting people focused on, you know, understanding what the pride is or the programs that are happening within the school. So, yeah, I'm signed up to go again. I definitely think that there was value in going last year.
One thing I would add is that we are, Hudson School District is presenting at the state convention this year on community engagement and our process that we used to engage the community over the past couple years, year and a half with the, not really just the passage of the referendum, but how we went from failing a referendum to getting... Yeah, no, you're fine. Getting to that point, which was a lot of engaging the community and getting feedback and things. So we will be presenting that first day right at 8 o'clock, right out of the chute. So if anybody would like to attend or see us, that'd be great. So
so far, I think I heard from Sue that she wouldn't be able to make it, but I hadn't heard from the other board members yet.
Is it going to be videoed?
The presentation?
I'm sorry, the presentation.
We could probably figure out a way to do that. We have other video from state convention last year, presentations and things like that, so I don't know why we wouldn't do this as well. So, absolutely. Moving on to the next item, which is the construction update. This one takes a little bit longer. You're able to click on the Raider recap. Just a couple of items as you look through it. The middle school, start with the middle school progress. They have started officially breaking ground and actually using equipment to start the process at the middle school. We do have a time-lapse camera that we have set up at the middle school. Tracy, are we going to be putting some of those links on our website so you'll be able to see some of those components? And then in the end, we're hoping to put together a time-lapse video of the construction of that project. But we did have that groundbreaking on October 18th. It was about as nice of a night as we could ask for. It was also coincided with our community meeting as well. This is an exciting project. Right now, things are moving on schedule and, knock on wood, on budget. So we'll continue to push forward on those items. We would anticipate that in the next, either the end of next week or the first part of the week at Thanksgiving, that you'll see footings and foundations in the ground. And when we come back, about the first week of December is when you'll see the wall panels set at the middle school. And the wall panels, once you see those up, those will be, there'll be a building there. So it'll go up in about 10 days is what it will take them to essentially set the structure of the building. It'll move very quickly. And then from there, you know, we'll have the getting the roof on it, windows in it, and then working through the inside of the building. So a lot of different moving parts at the middle school, but we feel pretty good about the direction we're heading and where we're at. We did just release bid pack 3, which is everything basically that goes inside the box. So from HVAC to carpet to electrical to flooring to paint to lights to all of those different components. So all of that has just been released. Those bids are due, I believe, on the 29th of November. They're due at 2 o'clock. The reason we're going to have a special meeting after that, and we won't actually approve those bids the night of that work session, is because one of the things that Krauss does for us after we get bids is they go through the bids and then they vet them to make sure that they're correct, to make sure vendors didn't miss something on a drawing, or make sure that, you know, they're able to do the work. You know, sometimes what will happen is people will bid on a project, but maybe the scale or size of the project is more than they can handle, and part of what we're paying Krauss to do is vet those things. So our last bid pack that we accepted bids on the structural steel, the concrete work, and then the steel construction part, we had a couple of changes to the low bid because there were some things that they were missing in the bid pack, which they still came in well under budget, at least those bids did, but Krauss went through, caught those items, made sure they got adjusted in their bids. And
so 2 days is enough time for them to do that?
Yeah, they usually, a couple of, and we're not going to be doing all of the bid packs or all of the scopes of work at that special meeting, just a couple of the items that have long lead time for ordering. The bulk of the items, there's 21 scopes of work that are, I think, in bid pack 3. So that's 21 different actual bids that we'll be getting. And so just primarily the items that have a long lead time. There's going to be some HVAC equipment that has long lead times. Windows have long lead times. And then some roofing materials and things like that. Everything else we'll be approving at the regular board meeting in December.
So some of those 21 will be on December 1st, and the rest will be done on
correct.
The regular board meeting, which I think is December 8th.
Yes.
And then I just want to say before we move on to the high school, the middle school, I was there this morning and volunteering for that reading project with the boys in the boat. And it already looks different with all the greenery out of that courtyard area. All the trees have been removed. There's not a blade of grass left, it looks like, and that there's some gravel and dirt. And hard to imagine that this time next month, then there's going to be walls up, not just a foundation poured.
Yeah, by this time next month, the building structure itself should be up. And so, you know, it's still estimated completion time end of the school year of this year for the new part of the building, and then doing some of the remodeling on the inside of the building, connections and things along those lines. That will happen after school's out in June. So we're still on track and in a good spot. The high school project is moving along quite well as also. We've spent a lot of time finalizing floor plans and working through that. We've met with a lot of teacher groups to get their feedback, and they would respond to things, and then Bray would go back and work on them, and then we'd bring them back to the next meeting, bring that group back and get some feedback again. So we think after tomorrow, we have our all-day meeting scheduled for tomorrow. The goal is hopefully by the end of the day tomorrow, as far as the layout of the building, we're feeling like we're in a pretty good spot. And then we're able to start to get into more details on the inside of the building. The exterior or the site work on the building, we did send the the preliminary review to the city on our site work. We will be getting that full report on Wednesday from the city. They had a traffic engineer study what they'd like us to do with some of the entrances and exits and things like that. We did get kind of a brief update from the city, and I think kind of the 30,000 foot level of what we have coming on Wednesday, and I think it seems like a very doable situation. We'll probably end up moving our west exit and entrance further west from what it sounds like, and some of those things. But for the most part, I think as far as the traffic flow and everything around the site was looking to meet people's needs. Once we get those things done, we have a conditional use permit we'll be filing with the city, because in order for us to have lighting posts above 45 feet, we have to do what's called a conditional use permit. Most people know it as a variance, but it's actually called a conditional use permit. So we'll be seeking a variance for, conditional use permit for the stadium lights and the tennis court lights as well. The determination, we have no plans right now to light the practice fields on the northeast corner, but we could, if we wanted to, submit for that as well, so that it is done and they're all done together. But we'll get some feedback, I think, from the construction committee tomorrow afternoon, how they'd like to proceed. We did get proposals from 7 different companies for artificial turf for both the stadium field and the practice fields. We're going to be putting together a committee of folks. We'll be going through that tomorrow with the construction committee, but working through the different stakeholder groups that will be involved in that selection. And part of the reason why we're trying to get that done early is it's a big chunk of the site project, and it can kind of dictate some of the other components with that. The site, we would expect that the site at the high school is going to go out to bid like the first week in January. And so we keep reminding everybody it's middle of November right now, and the time is really clicking awfully quick. So the site work will go out in January for bid. That's going to be the stadium project, the parking lots, the stormwater, the practice fields, all the site work. And then April 3rd is when Bray will have the drawings for the rest of the building. Basically, it's bid pack 2 at the high school.
What's that date?
That's April 3rd.
Okay.
We may have different components of that done before then, but prior to even getting close to that point, obviously we'll be getting board approval to continue to move forward. We're also planning at either December work session or December meeting to have Bray and Krause come in and kind of walk you through the budget at the high school and at a somewhat of a high level, but that in, as we found out when we went through the budget with them last week, we were 5 hours into it. We were about halfway through it. And so we probably won't go to that level of detail with the board, unless you're really, you know, dying to get into it. But you know, it'll probably take an hour or two to go through the budget of the high school. It's a very complex project. There's 40 different zones in the building. They have different scopes of renovation and addition. And so just so that everybody understands basically what the scope is in the different areas of the building. And just kind of saying, okay, in this area of the building, generally we're planning ceilings, flooring, wall coverings, HVAC, things like that. Okay, in this area of the building, we're planning on moving some walls here. We're planning on, you know, upgrading this or upgrading that. And so that way the board will have a full understanding of what the level of renovation scope is in the building, because that's a large chunk of the budget. And then obviously going through the new addition part of the building too. So all of those components will be coming up, working with Bray to see when they're going to be, which meeting that's going to work best for. The other thing that we have going on is we are taking a group of teachers and administrators down to Merchandise Mart in Chicago to look at school furniture for the buildings. It is a 4.3 million square foot furniture store that basically has every, I think, piece of furniture ever created. It's a large building. It's about 25 stories of furniture. But what they do is we'll take a group down. I think we have you know, four or five teachers from the high school going, three or four teachers from the middle school going, and some administrators. And what you're able to do is see the furniture, sit in the furniture, see if it's going to work or what people want. And we want feedback from staff as we look at ordering furniture with these two projects. Some furniture we'll reuse that we have, and some furniture we need different furniture. So that is coming up December 5th and 6th, or December 5th, I guess I should say. We'll head down there and head back. So it should be a good project. So
do you want to also mention, Nick, since our last meeting, last regular meeting, we've had three tours of area schools?
Yeah, so we have toured, several board members have toured different buildings. We have toured Prescott High School, which is to the south of us.
That's the most brand new one.
The most recent building that was also done by our architect, Bray. A very nice, well-done building. And as we talked about through the tour, sometimes when things look really nice, they don't have to be expensive to look really nice. Same thing at New Richmond High School. It's a very nice building. It was done very well, but as we talked about, it's concrete floors, polished concrete floors, and it's burnished concrete block walls. I mean, it looks really nice, but it's basically the same construction that you would construct prisons, I mean, and other durable facilities. So people might look at it and say, well, boy, this is a really over-the-top thing, but it's really not. It's just you can do a lot of really nice things with durable materials and things. And then we went over and saw Eastridge. Some of us took a trip over to Eastridge, which is over at South Washington. Now, that is one of the older of the three, but most like ours. It has 1,830 kids, I think, going through that building. Saw some really neat and innovative things over there. And also saw the challenges associated with running that amount of students through a building, how important it is to have durable products in a building in order to hold up to the wear and tear.
Yeah, because that building is only like 9 years old.
Yes. Yeah. So yeah, we've had some different projects that people have toured. And then I think we have a group of individuals going to Alexandria on Thursday. And I think, Sue, you're heading there with them as well to take a tour of the Alexandria High School. And that's up by St. Cloud, is that? I'm trying to get my bearings on Minnesota. I'm just learning Wisconsin. Now you're asking me to understand Minnesota.
Yeah.
So, okay. So should be kind of a neat thing. And what?
But there was a video that was passed around, right? I mean,
there is a video that was passed around as well. And if you haven't had a chance to look at it, I'd be more than happy to send you a link as well. So that's the construction update and where we're at. You know, tomorrow we'll have another meeting. We'll get more progress updates at the high school. We're kind of at the middle school. We're kind of in a process mode where we're actually into construction. So now it's managing the construction. Whereas the high school, we're heading into a very detail oriented design mode. So,
Mr. President.
Yes, Bruce.
A couple things, Dr. Nick. One, can you maybe talk a little directionally in terms of where the stormwater I guess, what we're going to be doing there. I know at one point in time we were talking about maybe having to go underground, and then we thought we could maybe go above ground. Could you talk about that? And then I'll address my second question.
Okay. So, yeah, we're very limited in square in space at the high school site, so trying to find where our stormwater goes can be a difficult problem. You know, the new stormwater controls basically says we have to hold our water on site when it rains for about 24 hours before we can release it into the storm sewer system. And since we have so much of our site that's going to be paved, that means we're holding a lot of water on site that's not just going to percolate down into the ground. So originally we were thinking we're going to have to bury it in large tanks underground and then, you know, basically release it into the storm sewer after 24 hours. But now we're able to use a water feature on the south, kind of south central, southwest corner of the property. And what that's able to do, it'll be a wet pond type of thing, but it not only do you have to hold your water on site, you have to clean it before it leaves your site. So you can't just let runoff from your parking lot leave the parking lot and then head into the streams and things like that. So what this pond does is it acts as a place to store water. It also cleans the water. Not exactly 100% sure how that all works. And then eventually it works its way into the storm sewer system, and then some of it actually just percolates out. And so we're able to save close to about $1 million with that process. And as we were doing that, we realized the way we were trying to do our parking lots, that's what allowed us to change the way we do our parking lots, which then impacted our tennis courts, and it just kind of trickled in there. We're finding that every time we peel back one layer of the onion, there's quite a few more layers as we try to solve some of these things. But so stormwater right now, that retention pond on the front will handle probably about 80% of the site's water.
Presume probably more aesthetically pleasing as well.
It will be aesthetically pleasing. It'll have fountains in it. It won't be a pond where you think of algae and things like that. We refer to it as a water feature because it'll be right at the main entrance when you come in, and so we'll make sure that it's well kept and it looks nice. It's not going to be a wild retention, like a retention bed where you just kind of see random plants and things like that in there. It'll actually be an actual functional pond.
Thanks.
Mr. President.
One more quick question. Can you maybe just talk also a little bit about the involvement and the engagement with those individuals that will be using the facilities? And I only ask this and maybe ask you to touch on it because it does seem to come up often in the communities where people are concerned that we're not just off, you know, creating all these, you know, features and building everything without really getting teachers' input and other individuals, staff that work within the building. So maybe okay. Just speak to that if you could, please.
Yeah, absolutely. So through the middle school process, we met several times this summer with the middle school teams and teachers that are going to be using those spaces. They created a Google Doc that was shared with our architect then where they could put things on the Google Doc and react to spaces and science labs and house spaces and things like that. And so there was quite a bit of feedback there. The same thing with our, we have some special ed spaces at the middle school that are being redesigned. And so met with the CID teachers and the ID teachers and Tony from student services to make sure that what we were doing there was meeting their needs. At the high school site, we've had representatives from every department meet multiple times with the architects. When people have questions about things, the architects say, hey, we're hearing what you're saying, let us go back. Let's look at potentially trying to get what you're saying and put it down on paper and making adjustments. The ag program, for example, I think she was back for meetings almost four different occasions over a 2-month period. Science, you know, several times, tech ed several times, and some of the other humanity areas. We've met with fine arts folks to talk about the auditorium design and things along those lines. We do realize that with the auditorium, something that's different than what people are realizing is when you do a renovation, you have to make things ADA compliant. There's no gracious entrance onto the stage from within the auditorium. So that means we have to figure out how to put a ramp up to the stage for the auditorium. And so that redesigns a little bit of the layout because if someone is wheelchair bound or needs that accessibility, the expectation is that they're able to access the stage without having to leave the auditorium and come back
come back in. And so we're working through some of those things and taking into account the feedback from our choir folks and our music folks and our play folks on those things. You know, the high school administrative staff, as far as the functionality of the building, how to supervise it, how to work through some of those things. We met with coaching staff about a month and a half ago just to talk about athletic spaces and the types of things that they're looking at. They'll be involved in the turf selection. We must have changed it two or three times, the jumping events for track. At first they wanted them inside, then they wanted them out, and then they wanted them, then we couldn't get them out, and then we had to move them around. And so, we've been responding to staff kind of all the way through. So our meetings, as you can see in your Google Drive, they're all broken down constantly by departments there, sometimes in half-hour, 15-minute increments or an hour increment. And what Peg has done is she's brought representatives in from those different areas to be a part of those meetings as we've gone through some of those things. Strive, for example, redesigning their area based on what they say they need. We've redesigned the CID and ID spaces at the high school based on what their recommendations were and things along those lines. Media center, we're going to get into more tomorrow. The main office was, you know, designed by the folks that are going to be utilizing those spaces. We have Peg Eller, our director of food nutrition, is involved in the design of the servery areas at the high school and also the kitchen redesign on some of those things. Jim Stazgill, our director of buildings and grounds, is at the forefront of all the decisions, constantly asking the question, okay, what impact is this going to have on maintenance staff, long-term maintenance of a building, long-term operating costs, things along those lines. So there are a lot of people providing a lot of input. We know that sometimes not everybody's going to get what they want, and we have to say no. And it's not because we're trying to be mean or anything like that, but we just we can't get to everybody's wants. And one of the things I've told people is we're going to deal with your needs and we're going to take care of your needs, and we'll probably get quite a few of your wants as well, but we definitely won't be able to get all of your wants. It's just that was never designed to be the case. So lots of input. There's a lot of people on the team that have put a lot of time into making sure that we're hitting those things.
Thank you.
Yes, President. Rob. Dr. Nick, as far as the retaining pond water feature, the intent is for that to stay wet year-round?
You may be asking a question that may be beyond what I understand. I mean, we wouldn't be draining it, so right. It would potentially freeze over. But, you know, again, I would have to ask the civil engineer and get back to it. Now, I wouldn't anticipate seeing fountains going in January when it's negative 20, but more than likely, if we don't drain it, it's probably going to freeze over. Potentially extra ice space for hockey, things along those lines.
Mr. President.
Hit more wants.
All right. Can I ask a question?
Yes.
The water feature, is that going to be filtering the water through artificial pumps and stuff, or is it going to be, I've seen these features where they plant the right kind of plants in them, and there's no other kind of filtration equipment other than the plants that are in it that continually clean the water. Is that what it's going to be?
Yeah, that's exactly right. There's actually, it'll look like one giant pond, but there'll be different depths, depths and different layers of plants under the water level. The only reason we use the fountains is really it's more for aesthetics than anything, and to keep the top of the water circulating so that we don't end up with the algae.
They work really well. If that's what it's going to be, filtering by plants, it works really well.
We're trying to minimize the, you know, obviously the fewer things that are moving,
right.
The less chance there's something breaking. So, it's turned out to be a great thing that the engineers were able to come up with. Again, it's kind of the water comes into the first pond. Again, if you were to look at it, you would think it's all just one pond, but there's actually several ponds within the pond. The way it kind of filters, like you said, filters water and then it lets it out.
They look really nice, and you can you put some benches and stuff out there around them, and you know, so that the people can go and sit and enjoy the sound of the water?
We would anticipate that, you know, part of what we've told the neighbors on all the sides, especially those on the east side that are going to be probably closest to the stadium, is that we do have a pretty healthy landscape budget. And, you know, the architects obviously are very aware of that's one of the first things you're going to see when you walk in
and drive onto the site. So they want it to be aesthetically pleasing with benches, with places, and some of those components. What you see in the picture up there, obviously it's not the end all be all, but what you see is raised planting beds that you're able to sit on. You know, they kind of act as both a planting bed and a seat. You know, they sit about 2 feet in the air, 18 inches to 2 feet in the air. And you'll see some of those types of things throughout the site. Tomorrow will be our first look at the landscape plan. So we have not seen a first crack at their site landscape plan, but we're excited to see that tomorrow.
One other question. I see in that picture there's an American flag flying there. That is part of this, isn't it? That is going to be there?
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. There'd be a flag. Flag is always... the exception of our current high school is always usually signifies the main entrance to a building. So usually if that's just kind of a little piece of trivia, if you're wondering where is the front of the building or where do I go in, usually if you look for the American flag, that should designate the main entrance to a building with the
Thank
exception
you.
Of our current high school. So.
All right. Any other questions?
Mr.
Carrie?
President?
Yes.
With the 7 teachers and administrators that go to Chicago to look at furniture, not getting into specifics, but will they be somewhat representative of the size of a 6th grader through a 12th grader if they're actually going to be trying them out?
Are you saying that I'm not representative of a 6th grader? Is that what you're getting at? I'm representative of several 6th graders.
She's quite perceptive.
So, no.
Well, I mean, there's a huge variance, but...
Yeah. Jeez, this is awfully... You're getting after me pretty good.
No.
I mean, huge variance. No, really, it's really looking at that functionality, because a lot of the furniture, especially once you get up into upper elementary, the size of the furniture doesn't change. It's like moves into adult mode furniture. So where you're starting to see smaller furniture and things like that is where you're going to see in the primary grades of the elementary and things like that. But, you know, I think the big thing we're looking at is, you know, what types of furniture would facilitate the type of instruction you want to do and the type of learning you want to see happen. And then it wouldn't be, okay, let's order furniture just from this trip. It would be, oh, this is really interesting. It'd be really great if we could get a couple of these and have the kids try them out over the next month or two and give us some feedback type of thing. And so that's what I would envision, that we would use this to say, okay, here's, you know, 5 or 6 different chairs that we really like or that we think are gonna be really good. Let's order a few of each and let kids utilize them for a few months and see how they work and give us some feedback that way. So yeah, eventually they'll be able to do that.
An example was at East Ridge when they showed us, it was kind of a newfangled student desk that was pretty cool because it had a rotating desktop and could also fold down, so it could be multiple use kind of chair that had, I think it was on wheels too.
Yeah, I mean, the desktop could spin in either direction. The chair could spin in either direction. So if you were sitting there and you say, hey, okay, turn to your partner and work through this, easily able to do those things much easier than what they could do in normal chairs, things along those lines. You know, same thing with desk and tables and flexible furniture. So, you know, the name of the game, both with the design at the middle school and the design of the high school, is flexibility. And we know that what we're designing is something that's going to be used for the next potentially 50 or 60 years before something happens again. And so trying to plan for things that you don't know are going to be waves in education. And so just trying to keep things as flexible as possible.
Also, yeah, flexibility, diversity too, because what's a good desk for English class isn't something that you necessarily use in science and so forth. So I thought that's what I was struck by on these tours that we did. Even Prescott, being a smaller school, they had quite a range of different types of furniture for different types of rooms.
Yeah, it's a great point. I mean, some classes, you know, you need to be able to put your textbook out and be able to write and do those things. In other classes, that's not as important. You know, even something as simple as different stools at different heights in art classrooms or science classrooms and things like that make them more conducive to drawing and doing experiments. So it should be pretty exciting. We're looking forward to a...
We should also emphasize that when it comes to the furniture, we're not necessarily replacing every stick of furniture in the high school.
I am constantly reminding our building principals that that is the case. You know, if furniture is in good shape, we obviously want to reuse to the best of our ability. I think if we have furniture that has kind of outlived its usefulness for us, but maybe still has life left, you know, we would do what we've done in other cases where we've done community sales and things like that. Sometimes there's other entities that want to purchase that from the district. and given those opportunities. But yeah, one of the things they said is we are not going to have nice pieces of furniture sitting in dumpsters just because it's not new.
Yeah. So. All right. Yep. Any other questions? Thank you for that thorough report, Dr. Nick, and it kind of is a great segue to my report. Was going to be brief, just about community engagement and transparency, and I hope folks recognize that just because the referendum passed and we've hired an architect and hired a construction manager, that the community engagement stops. We've already had two meetings. We had community meeting in August and then one in October. And as Dr. Nick alluded to, we probably wouldn't be able to get one in before Christmas break just because there's a lot going on at that point, but probably shortly after the first of the year. And then, you know, we had promised those at least once a quarter, and we might be able to do our next one around the time of the groundbreaking. We haven't set that date yet for the high school, but we would anticipate it being sometime late March. So all of that continues. Plus, you know, we do have that newfangled website, which I think is great, and I've heard compliments on it, that it's much easier to navigate than its predecessor, and we're always updating that website with construction, and we'll even have this time lapse photography with the how the project is doing, and so that's exciting. And you know, it was a long process, and we're not only going to be doing a presentation at the convention, but I also wanted to bring our fellow board members' attention and the public's to some fairly new news, because Nick just forwarded it to me tonight, but we learned, what is it, late last week, Tracy, that our school has received a WISPRA award. It's right up there with the Tonys and the Oscars, but it's a acronym for Wisconsin School Public Relations Association. For over 25 years, they've recognized schools for exemplary public relation efforts, and schools can submit portfolios of their public relation works in 10 different categories, and they're judged by professionals in Illinois. So they take that whole subjective, any favoritism out of it by having Wisconsin people do it. Anyway, this year there was over 90 portfolios submitted. There were 26 schools receiving awards across the state. Hudson submitted a portfolio on our community engagement and referendum campaign. We were one of six schools to receive a perfect score from the judges, and we're receiving a 2016 Spectrum Award of Excellence. The comments from the judges included excellent package of information. They appreciate the amount of information presented and the efforts at transparency, beautifully designed. And number three, this project is a massive undertaking. Its goals and objectives were very clearly stated, and appropriate due diligence was clearly given to research and planning. So kudos to everyone involved. I mean, it started with the committee that Bruce and I served on, I didn't want to use the acronym, but the process steward team, yes, and the PST. and then, of course, also our superintendent came in July, right in the middle of that effort. And so Tracy was, of course, overseeing the whole thing. And so I think with Tracy's efforts, that beautifully designed, I think she's got to take a lot of credit. So let's give her that credit now. So anyway, good work, guys, and continue to encourage the community to, you know, check out our website, ask questions, come to the meetings. Now we'll move on to topics for action, and I'll entertain a motion for consent items. I know we're all lost because Lynn, as president, usually makes this motion, and so those that have 20/20 vision, somebody could make the motion.
I'd like to move to approve of the consent items, and that the Director of Financial Services be authorized to pay bills in the amount of $2,643,104.69.
Second.
All right, motion by Carrie, second by Bruce. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
The consent items pass. Next up is to appoint a board member as delegate to the state convention that Dr. Nick alluded to and we talked about before. As we stated, Rob and Bruce attended last year. I wasn't able to because of a personal emergency, but I plan on going this year. And Bruce, you said you're planning on going. Rob, are you up for going again this year?
I am.
All right. And is anyone else planning to go for sure? All right.
I think Lynn said she might be going.
Yes, I did hear that Lynn wanted to be able to go. With that, though, I have not had anyone come forward except for Rob as far as wanting to serve as the delegate. So if there's anyone that else that wanted to be considered, we could have a popular election and do an electoral college. And
I would strongly suggest that Rob continue as our delegate.
Okay.
Second.
All right. Moved and seconded. All in favor say aye.
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 Rob, you are unanimously elected delegate second year running. All right.
Don't let it go to your head.
Just like the commercial, right? Yeah. All right. Moving on to topics for action, four-year-old kindergarten. I've turned it over to Dr. Nick on this with the introduction that this is a subject that first introduced when Dr. Ouellette, when he interviewed for the job. I think I recall you asking that question is, how come that's not something that has been part of our programming here? And so it was agreed that we would at least explore it, look into it, and he's done that. We've now discussed it at least two meetings, and now this is up for an action item. I don't know, Dr. Nick, who you want to suggest. I see Dave out of the corner of my eye motioning, maybe he, because he helped.
I'm scratching my ear.
All right. He'll put together the frequently asked questions and made a great presentation to the board at our last work session. So
yeah, I will. I'll be turning it over to Dave and to Sue to go through certain components. I can also touch on some of the finances.
Just to clarify, Sue Helmers, right?
Sue Helmers. Yeah, yep. Okay. I'm sorry, not Sue Katas. Sue, you're going to need to present for 4K. Are you ready? But I'll be turning it over to them. You know, I know there were some questions and things that people had at the last board work session or special meeting as far as pros and cons and working through that. We try to do it in a form of frequently asked questions and to work through some of the cons as they are associated with that and then also kind of give some background. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Dave to start on the background, and if there's anything, chime in.
All right, perfect. Thank you very much. So as Nick said, this is a presentation that in large part has already been given. So we want to review some of the highlights of the presentation and then get into some of the new information that we want to bring to you tonight. So first of all, in the state of Wisconsin, since 2008, 413 school districts have started 4K programs. There are currently 11 school districts left that have not, and we are obviously one of them. And with that, Wisconsin really has been a trailblazer in this idea of the community-based approach to 4K programming. And what we mean by community-based 4K programming is that the majority of the services are provided with community-based partners as opposed to in existing schools. Our approach, we'd be looking at a large majority in the community with just a few classrooms in our existing schools. The other thing I wanted to touch on real quickly was essentially two bodies of research that speak to this concept. The first one is really from the benefit to the students. And there is a lot of research out there that supports the benefits of 4K programming or consistent preschool programming. You'll find it named different things depending on the state and the different structures that are being involved. And you'll notice that our most recent research that we cited in that last presentation was 2008. So I went back to some of those same researchers to see what they were doing, to look at some more recent research. I've got quite a bit here. And the interesting thing about the way the educational research works, it starts out very broad and it becomes more and more specific as time goes on, as people start to answer more specific questions. So interesting information that we found there, but again, very supportive of the concept of consistent 4K programming. The other body of research deals with the return on investment and some very interesting research that essentially states you get a very significant return on investment for preschool education, consistent and high quality preschool education. And that's something that's very important as a community. Again, we recognize that we already have some very top-notch 4K programs in our community. We want to partner with those folks, and we want to make sure that we can offer 4K programming to all of our four-year-olds in the school district. A couple things before I pass it on. First of all, I'll be passing on to Sue Helmers, and she has done a tremendous amount of work with the research and meetings, and really serving as a liaison to our state representatives too, that help answer questions we have about 4K. So in just a second, I will pass it over to her, but a couple quick announcements that I want to get in, make sure it's part of the record. So if approved tonight, a couple things will happen. First of all, we'll immediately start reaching out to the partners to start forging those partnerships. One thing that has to happen in order to finalize those partnerships is have a contract in hand, so we at least have a draft of a contract that we can talk about what does that relationship actually look like. We currently have a draft that's being reviewed by a few folks, and we'll be able to get that out very soon. The other thing is that on December 1st, we would have a community meeting. That would be right here, December 1st at 6 p.m., open to the entire community, anyone that wants to see a brief presentation, and then also an opportunity for questions and answers. That would be December 1st, 6 p.m., right here at ASC. And with that, I'm going to pass it over to Sue Helmers, who's going to talk a little bit about the benefits of 4K for Hudson.
Hi, my name is Sue Helmers. Probably the two main objectives or things that Dave and I have been focusing on are these two benefits. One being increased access to preschool. So right now we currently have about 80% of our kindergartners attending a preschool program. We would like to provide an opportunity so that all kids would have equal access. If there were portions of that 20% that for some reason were unable to attend due to financial, transportation, something like that, we would like to make sure that we do have opportunities for all of them. The 4K program is optional, so it isn't required by anybody or by the state, but we just want to make sure that we're allowing anybody that is interested to have access. The second thing that we're really focused on is increased quality and consistency within our programs here in the city of Hudson. We've met with many, Dave and I have met through the early childhood networking group. We've met with faith-based program directors just to make sure that we are all working collaboratively together. And our vision for the future is that with this program in place, the 4K program would become a part of our school district, kind of our whole K-12, making it a pre-K-12 program. But through that collaborative effort, we'd be able to work together to really focus on best meeting the needs of our students. Do you want to talk?
We'll pass it over.
Talk a little bit about the finances as it relates to it, and Tim can chime in here as well. So we're unique in Hudson compared to a lot of other districts because of our under levy and because of our property values. And so essentially what happens is by adding these students to the district, we generate a certain amount of state aid, and that state aid comes to us not in the form of property tax or property tax levy, but you know, actually from the state. Not taking advantage of the state aid component of this does not mean that your taxes are going to go down, and it doesn't mean that your taxes are going to go up if we do take advantage of this. It's a pool of money that's already been allocated statewide, and it's us trying to get a larger chunk of that pool back to our residents here. So as Dave alluded to, and so did Sue, about a community-based program, so it's the providers are primarily existing providers, current facilities. It's not our intention, nor do we want to house 4K in our own buildings. We potentially have maybe one classroom on the north side of the district and one classroom on the south side of the district to meet the needs of some of those students that choose that. But our intention is to run this program as a community-based program, so it's not to become competition with our community-based providers. A couple things with the numbers, and up there it talks about anywhere from 57 to 5785 estimated additional state aid per student. The thing that's somewhat misleading about that is because when we add additional students to the to our count, it impacts our negative tertiary aid and some of those other things. So it's not actually getting $5,700 just for those individual kids. It actually raises the amount of state aid we get for all kids, K-12. And so it's just that when you're looking at somewhere between 300 and 360 kids or something like that in 4K, if you were to take about what we would get in additional state aid and divided by that many kids, that's where you're getting that number. I know some people have asked, well, if you're getting $5,700 and you're only reimbursing the community programs $3,200, that seems like a smaller amount. Well, the kids themselves don't actually generate the full $5,700. That's a combination of all of our kids K-12 generating additional aid because our negative tertiary aid doesn't go so negative. So that's something to keep in mind. The $3,200 reimbursement per student in community agency to the community agency is the highest that we know of in the state. So we think it's a good thing. It's given our providers more money than just about any other district is reimbursing their providers. When you add in our district costs, which is transportation and some oversight costs and things like that, it's about $4,100 per kid. So the other roughly $1,600 per kid is primarily reflected in the additional aid that we're getting for all of our other K-12 kids because we've added this program. That's about $400,000 to $500,000 a year in additional state aid that could be used for other things within our district. And so again, this is state aid. It's not levying additional property tax. I understand people will say, well, state aid is tax, and I get that. But by not doing this, it's not as though our taxes are going to go down. It's just this money is going to go to a different district. It's just not going to go to us. And so that's one of the things. Obviously, we feel strongly about the educational impacts of 4K, but we think financially it makes a lot of sense for our providers. It makes a lot of sense for our district as well, we think, and for our parents, because that reimbursement is to help offset what parents would have to pay if they had 4K or they had to pay for 4K themselves. So at this point, you know, we would entertain questions, or we could even go through the frequently asked questions. And Dave could probably walk through the 4K frequently asked questions.
Yeah, you bet. I'll talk a little bit about the formation of this document, and then actually I'm going to pass it to Sue to respond to a few of the issues. First of all, I realized there was one question that was asked that we did not include here. One of the questions asked was, are there districts in the state of Wisconsin that have started a 4K program and then decided to pull out and stop 4K programming? So we talked to our regional liaison through DPI, and she was not aware of any programs that pulled 4K programming. So of the 438 districts, she was not aware of any that started and then pulled out. Obviously, many have adjusted and changed, as we would anticipate doing, as you look to continually improve the program, but none that she was aware of that had stopped programming. As you look at the frequently asked question document, you'll notice that they're all stated sort of in the same way, where you can hear some of the criticism. And I responded last month to the biggest con of 4K programming is poor implementation. And I stand by that and believe that to be the case, that there are all sorts of things you could do that would not really be good for four-year-old students and four-year-old learners. We obviously are not planning on doing those. So the questions that you'll see are stated like that. I'm going to pass it over to Sue to talk about the first three, as we believe these are the ones that are actually frequently asked at this point. We believe this will be a living document as more questions come in. We would anticipate questions when we meet with providers. We would anticipate questions when we meet with community members. And we will make sure that we put together a response so people are informed. With that, I'll pass it to Sue.
So as Dave said, we tried to find some information that would get to some of the questions that were raised last time we met. And one of the ones that we keep hearing is, what is the focus of 4K, and is it just kind of a mini kindergarten or a push down from kindergarten? The 4K program that we are proposing for Hudson is really focused on developmentally appropriate things for four-year-olds. We want to provide a social, provide social experiences in an environment that is play-based, is creative, is exploratory, is exactly what we feel four-year-olds need in order to grow and learn. Active social interaction, lots of choices, small groups, big groups, lots of books, just exposure to things that we know are going to help prepare them for kindergarten. This also provides an opportunity throughout the 4K program for community outreach, which would also allow us to work with families and to really bring the community together around the focus on 4K. Is it just free childcare was another question. As a district, we are providing about 2 to 2.5 hours per day of the for the 4K program. There are opportunities, or we're anticipating opportunities for wraparound care, but that would be at the expense of the family. The part that is covered by the district is the 2.5 hours a day, or 10 to 12 hours per week. So it is free for that portion. For those people that are interested, and as I mentioned earlier, the 4K program is completely optional, but all four-year-olds in our district would be given access to that program.
So Sue, just if I could interject, the wraparound care would be something that would be a function of the community-based providers. It's not the district's intent to get into a competition with daycare providers or community-based providers. I mean, we have our school-age care that is before school and after school that families may take advantage of. That's, you know, if they happen to be in a morning session of 4K or something along those lines. But the wraparound care is really a function of each individual site and whether or not they want to do it.
Correct. So if the 4K is offered from, let's say, 9 to 11:30, but a family needs to drop their child off at 7:30 in order to get to work, they would pay privately for that 7:30 to 9. The 4K program would be paid for from 9 to 11:30, and then the remainder of the day, if the child stayed, would then be part of that wraparound care or private pay as well.
But not at our facility. We would not have the afternoon wraparound care.
No,
yeah,
correct.
That's what I just
correct.
Wanted to
at the community based. Yes.
Yep.
Yes.
Okay.
So, any right. questions?
Other questions?
May I ask a question?
Yes, Carrie.
And number three, you say it's optional. Would it, if they do opt for it, would they have to go 5 days?
At this point, that's kind of what we're looking at, are five 2.5 hour days. Mm-hmm. But Dave and I have just been talking, and I think we're kind of still open to the planning. We are, like I said, meeting with some of the different organizations, some of the different daycares and preschools. But that right now is our vision. And I think we're
And I would agree with that. Although attendance isn't compulsory, we wouldn't create multiple programs with different schedules. We'd have consistent scheduling. The state reimbursement is based on a certain number of hours of instruction, so we would have to meet those hours.
And part of that would be determined by our ability to provide transportation, which is also a requirement that we have to at least provide an option for transportation, so that might allow or keep us to a half day rather than a full day, that sort of thing.
Mr. President?
Rob.
Gotcha. Just a handful of real quick questions. The facts, will this be on our website?
I believe she's busy doing it right now.
Fantastic. And question for Nick, Tim. We front the costs up front. We then receive compensation in arrears. Is that how this works? Okay. What happens if one of our teachers or one of our partners needs a teacher, has help around special ed, training, how does all that work?
Yeah, I can touch on that. So we're looking at a community-based model where the community-based program is providing the instructor as well. There are three actual different models. There's one where they provide the instructor, they offer it and teach in their own facility. There's a model where we provide the instructor but teach at their facility, or there's the model where we have the facility and we provide the instructor. If a center was having trouble finding a qualified individual to teach, then they could work with the district to find someone, and potentially if we needed to have a district employee do that teaching, we could do that. But our hopes is that we'll be able to work with our providers to find personnel that would be hired through them to be able to offer that instruction. As far as special education services, ELL services, any of the other special programs, we're already doing those things as part of our child find process that starts as early as age three, special education even earlier than that, depending on the needs. So the only thing we may be able to do is we may be able to identify some students a little bit earlier if they do have some challenges, because they'll be part of the program. But we're already doing those things and working with the private providers now to provide services.
Bruce?
Thank you. So can you go up to the top where you were talking about your objectives around the curriculum? Yeah, so maybe, Sue, you can maybe talk a little bit about interaction thus far. Assume there's probably a number of curriculum options out there for us to choose, and how you work with various community partners to determine what's the right curriculum that's going to work for the entirety of our community versus, you know, something that we're kind of choosing and then just pushing out to the community. So talk about that involvement, maybe what types of curriculum options we've been exploring thus far.
So I can touch on that. There are a few options out there, and we're looking most closely at creative curriculum teaching strategies, creative curriculum goal. I actually have samples of the material. We're focusing there because, first of all, they are well-researched, and they're by far the most prevalent curriculum used in Wisconsin-based 4K and throughout the country. And the other thing that we really like about it is the fact that it meets all of those benchmarks that we're looking at. It's a very active, inquiry-based curriculum, a lot of exploration, a lot of hands-on. Now, we still have, there are sort of ancillary curricular resources that may be part of the process too, but the focus right now is on creative curriculum. We have looked at a few others and, quite honestly, not overly impressed. We do want to talk to the providers once we reach out and start to forge those partnerships to see what they've got going on currently and see what adjustments we need to make.
And by we, you mean we the district or we the community?
It would be the district and the community providers.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. We are anticipating making an advisory council that would have members from the different community-based programs, Dave, myself, and so those would be some of the things. Dave and I kind of have an idea and a vision, but would like to work with this advisory council as well.
Okay. And to date, I know we talked about this last time, but you know, still feel that the 300 is reasonable. Last time I think we were at 250 to 350. Now it sounds like we're 300 to 360. I mean, is that, I thought last time we used the number 250 to 350.
Those numbers were used for budgeting purposes, okay. Just for forecasting. We would anticipate closer to 300, but we want to be ready for up to 350.
Okay.
Can you talk a little bit about how our community partners that maybe have religious-based instruction and how that would relate to adopting, you know, curriculum where we have consistency, you know, across the board?
Certainly, and that gets a little bit to that idea of the wraparound services. So during the 4K instruction, so say 2.5 hours a day, that would be the time during the day that religious instruction could not be taking place, but then any time outside of that 2.5 hour block, then religious instruction could be taking place. And the way we would anticipate that would work, we would go through, we still have to work through the details, but we're anticipating sort of a multi-tiered registration process that would allow families first to enroll in our community-based partners programs, and then we'd make the decision in terms of 4K placement. And what that would allow to do, what that would allow is to ensure that the families that are attending a faith-based program want to be there. They're selecting that institution, so they'd likely not have issues with the faith-based instruction. But what happens outside of those 2.5 hours is completely at the discretion of the provider, and that would include then the faith-based instruction.
Up to and including what's in the facility, where they're teaching within the facility. I mean, there's no dictation on what they're doing, where they're doing it, just as long as they're following the curriculum?
Yeah, the curriculum and yes, is the short answer. We're not going to be in the business of inventorying classrooms to see if there's religious symbolism there. It's more about the instruction.
I think something to keep in mind with the curriculum is it's not a script. It's not, you know, on day one you do this, on day two you do this, and there's no way to deviate from that. It's about objectives and things you know different milestones you want kids to hit, and working with our 4K partners to make sure kids are hitting milestones and at certain timing and things like that. So I've been a part of we use creative curriculum in the last district I was at. It was the state standard in Iowa, the GOLD assessment. It's not an assessment that is a paper and pencil. A kid sits down and answers multiple choice questions. It's an observatory assessment. You know, the teacher's observing the students playing with their friends. There's teachers observing them in this setting. They're observing them in that setting and kind of working through some of those things, and then providing feedback for parents. You know, this is what we're observing. This is, you know, how things are going. Developmentally, are they hitting these different milestones and doing these things? So, you know, it kind of reiterates to what Dave said earlier. It's not a push down of kindergarten. You know, it's not our goal that every kid has every letter and every color and every shape and everything. Now, will they talk about letters and shapes and colors at times? Sure, but more of an interactive base, not we're going to, you know, sit here and draw the letter K for 2 hours while we all make sure everybody can draw the letter K. So it's just to see it implemented, a lot of people say, well, gosh, it doesn't seem much different than, you know, kids kind of interacting and playing. So it's kind of a, you know, playing with parameters and things along those lines. And it creates and teaches them a lot of those soft skills that kind of help them all the way through life, you know, working with others, coping with disappointments and things like that, and learning to collaborate and all those different components. So it has a proven track record.
All right.
Mr. President?
Yes, Carrie.
Back to the faith-based, just hypothetically speaking, mm-hmm. if the only option is what they're offering right now is strictly faith-based, they don't have a wraparound, what viable option would they have? Either to remove the faith component or not accept this proposal?
It would just be for those 2.5 hours that the instruction is taking place, that during that 2.5 hours a day, there's not explicit faith-based instruction occurring.
But if the program was 2.5 to 3 hours and that was it, what would be the option?
Then there would not, I mean, at okay. that point, there would not be an option.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
But those students, the district would be looking at providing transportation, so the student would come at that 9 o'clock, would get transportation from their home, get there at 9, and then have transportation back home if the parent wanted to make other arrangements mm-hmm. for after that. Does that make sense?
So 4K programming will be available to all students regardless of the school that they would want to attend or the provider they'd want to attend. We'd make sure that we have enough providers in geographic region we'd be able to provide services. But in terms of the provider themselves, yeah, if there is no flexibility to open up 2.5 hours a day to provide non-faith-based instruction aligned to the curriculum and the standards, then it wouldn't be an option. If they couldn't participate. Correct.
Okay.
Mr. President?
Yes, Bruce.
So that's assuming, though, that our community partners are interested in moving forward with this, right? So, I mean, if some aren't, I mean, mm-hmm. yeah, we could say we could provide it, but it could put more onus back on us if a community partner isn't interested in signing up. Is that a fair assumption?
Yeah, feasibly that could be the case. We've had several providers that have already sort of offered a soft commitment, and we have others that are interested but cautiously watching, and obviously they need to go through a decision-making process themselves. They have several stakeholders. They have their own boards that they need to answer to.
Sure.
But we're cautiously optimistic that we'll be able to satisfy the need.
Okay. And as far as... requirements, if you will, what mm-hmm. what does one need to show proof of in order to say I would like to provide this at my center.
Sure. There are some facility requirements in terms of play space and so forth. There are teacher licensure requirements, and then there are licensure requirements for the facility itself. The biggest challenge is teacher licensure, and we're currently looking at partnering with UW River Falls to offer some creative solutions to allow those folks that are already providers in Hudson, but do not have that DPI license, to see what we can do about sort of fast tracking that process and creating a very convenient offering for them.
Real quick, just to interject, I know we've spent a lot of time talking about faith-based providers and partners, but there are other providers, private providers and partners that aren't faith-based that could be a part of this program as well, that have reached out to us and that Dave and Sue have met with as well. And so obviously we have really strong faith-based providers and faith-based programs in the community, but we also have very strong non-faith-based providers that provide, you know, child care or preschool services and things like that. And so trying to, you know, we work with all of them as we work through this. So just something to kind of keep in mind.
Yep. A couple more questions. The size of classes you would anticipate being similar to what our kindergarten numbers are?
Actually smaller than the kindergarten numbers.
Smaller?
Yep. Yes.
So instead of 18 to 22, more like 15 to 20, 15
so
to
there's 18. I don't want to misquote myself here, but so there's actually two sets of numbers. What we have is a number for one teacher in a room, one licensed teacher, and if there's an assistant, there's another range. So I believe we're at 12 to 20 essentially would be the number we'd be looking at, depending on how it was structured.
All right, but again, for those whether faith-based or non-faith-based partners, I mean, if teacher was the issue, mm-hmm. It's something where they're getting $3,200 per student. They could hire a teacher with the ranges you're talking about. That's approximately $36,000 to, mm-hmm. To $60,000 to have available for paying the teacher.
Correct.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And then the 2.5-hour time frame, we'd be expecting like one teacher to be able to do a morning session and an afternoon. Is
correct.
That typical?
Exactly. Right. And that would depend on the provider. A provider would not have to commit to an AM and a PM session. They could say we're only going to have that AM session. For the few programs that we would have in district, we would be offering AM and PM, and that teacher would serve both.
Well, and that's what I was asking from our standpoint as far as using our space and
yes.
so forth. We'd want to try and have a balanced approach so that we're not having four morning sections and one afternoon.
Exactly.
And,
so yes.
And when we say using our space, just to clarify, we're really talking about, you know, using probably one classroom somewhere on the north side of the district and one classroom somewhere on the southern part of the district. It's not, the whole point of this program is to not bring 4K into our buildings. It's to really utilize the private providers. You know, again, it's a lot of times for us to provide it at different buildings, it's a matter of convenience for parents or things like that. But, you know, we have about 19 sections of kindergarten. And we're hoping that, you know, we're really only talking about two sections of 4K that's related to the district type thing.
All right. With that, I would, any other questions? Otherwise, we're ready for a motion. Yes. Sandy.
Just some questions and some comments. Our state aid is based on the number of kids enrolled in our district, and enrolling four-year-olds would increase our numbers, so therefore increase our state aid, correct? Okay.
And that impacts our negative tertiary aid, right? Correct, Tim?
Yeah, there's some leveraging in the formula, because as you increase the number of students, you know, property values, where they are here in Hudson, we wind up getting some leveraging action out of those additional students that come in, because it makes us look less property rich. When we're more property rich, that's when we start to lose aid. We gain less aid.
Right, I get that. If the number of students goes up, the way the formula works out, the aid per student goes up too, because we've got more students in this property, and it dilutes the whole thing if you add more students
right.
to the mix.
Right.
I got that, okay. You said that you expect that we will benefit to about $500,000 a year by doing this? That would be extra money that the district would have?
So that would be the expectation, is after paying all of our expenses, both to the providers and to district level expenses, that would be somewhere between $400,000 to $500,000 a year.
Okay.
In additional aid that would not needed to be used to offset cost associated with 4K.
Okay, and is that based on, what'd you say, 300 to 350 students enrolled?
Mark did the calculations on this.
Yeah, so it's between 150 and 210, what we would call FTEs, you know, so, and those FTEs count for about a 0.6, so, yeah. So that's how we're deriving that.
So each actual student only counts as a 0.6 because they're not here all day.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
So when Tim's talking about FTEs, he's taking partial children and adding them together. So
sorry to confuse.
Yeah. So yeah, just to kind of clarify, because it's can be confusing sometimes.
Yeah. How many students are currently enrolled in the Hudson School District in the private four-year programs?
I do not have that data.
So how do you know then we will get to what you're projecting?
We're basing that on kindergarten enrollment trends. So we're assuming that the number of four-year-olds that we would have in our community would be close to the same number of five-year-olds.
But they're not all attending.
Correct. Correct. So
are you assuming that they're all going to attend?
No, we're not assuming that all, but we're assuming, so right now we're at about 80%, and we'd assume that number would go up.
So where did you get the 80%?
That was the most recent data we had that was done, and I'm honestly not sure exactly when that was done, but we had some data that came in that suggested about 80% of our four-year-olds were receiving some kind of preschool education.
And that's in Hudson?
In Hudson, correct.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So if we have 350 kindergartners, then 80% of that is what would be equivalent to 80% of that is what we could expect to be.
That would mean that no other students would enroll. So we are assuming that because we're going to be offering a free 4K program, the number of students that participate will go up, because a certain percentage of that 20% that doesn't attend, they're not attending because they can't afford to attend.
Okay, I guess what I'm trying to get at is, The estimate of what we're going to gain by doing this, the $400,000 to $500,000, that's based on, you said, 300 to 350 enrolling.
Mm-hmm.
But how do we know that's going to happen? Well, we don't.
We don't, is the right.
So the $400,000 to $500,000 could be a substantially smaller figure if we don't get the enrollment that we are anticipating.
That is accurate.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
We've talked to several districts around us, and they run about 80 to 85% of their incoming kindergarten participate in their 4K. So that's kind of the standard around the state, is about 80 to 85% of the four-year-olds in their community participate. So we're kind of basing it on that as well.
Okay. But the $400,000 to $500,000 is based on the 80% then enrolling?
It's based on, if you take Tim's number, that essentially that 150 to 200 full-time equivalents, if you take that times the 0.6, it's a range from 250 kids to
350. 250 to 350 mm-hmm.
So
is the head
count.
Yeah.
Okay. In there.
So if it's closer to 250, the number will be 400. If it's 350, the number will be closer to 500,000.
Yeah. That's what we're anticipating.
Mm-hmm. To not have that number, it'd be all four-year-olds stop going to preschool.
Right. I get
yeah.
it. Are the busing costs, you said we have to bus these kids, mm-hmm. right? To mm-hmm. and from?
That's figured into the calculations.
That's included in the
yes.
calculations.
So part of what you're seeing there, that there's a $3,200 reimbursement to the agency, to the community. That extra $900 is what we're estimating district costs, busing,
program
oversight, things like that. So that's why there's a difference between 3,200 and the 41. The 4,110 is what we're estimating the entire cost to the district per kid.
Okay.
So we're building in, we're estimating, I think when we built the budget, about 50% of the students requiring transportation. Mm-hmm. It may not, you know, since we're doing a community-based model, it may be quite a bit less than that, because if they're already there receiving wraparound care on the front end and the tail end, usually they don't get on a bus to leave and then to come back.
Okay.
So, but, you know, conservatively, we want to say half of all the kids involved we'd have to transport.
Okay, so that difference, that $900, does that also include then if a lot of kids are identified as special needs or having issues or anything like that, that includes being able to hire the additional help, which we would have to hire, that wouldn't be in the community facility?
Correct.
Correct. I mean, services, there could be some services that would be provided, but that would be at our expense.
Okay, and that difference in that $900 per student is designed to cover that also, right?
Correct.
Okay, great, thank you. Yep. That was one question. Okay.
Mr. President.
Let's see here. Oh, one other question. Yeah. What if, so let's say all of the pre-K programs in Hudson right now say, oh, yeah, this is great, let's do it. Mm-hmm. And then after 1 or 2 years, they decide this is not working for us, we want out of this. Once we start this program, are we stuck with it then if they decide not to and we have to put it in our own buildings?
It would have to be mutually agreed upon, but a district or a partnering agency, it's going to be an annual contract. So they could change their mind after a year, and then we would likely seek a different or additional partners. That does happen. When the question about in other communities, that will happen. There will be providers that for whatever reason it doesn't work out anymore for them to participate. And then the district would seek additional spots in existing partnerships that have already been developed or additional partnerships.
And what if we had to move those students into our own buildings if we couldn't get anybody else in the community to pick them up?
I think what we would do is we would have to reassess the situation whether or not it continues to be a viable option then for the district. Okay. If we don't have enough community partners, really, as we've said time and time again, the goal is not to move 4K into our buildings. I mean, the one or two classrooms that we would have, one on the north side, one on the south side, is really just trying to balance things out, but it's not, our goal is not to eventually move this all to our buildings. If all of a sudden all of our partners said, we don't want to do it anymore, we don't have any community-based, you know, partners, then I think the conversation comes back to the board table and we have to say, maybe this isn't a program that's sustainable anymore, and
so
maybe we can pull up.
So there's no state requirement that once you start it, you keep it?
No.
No.
Okay.
It's a student count annually. So basically we have the count this year, we get paid for those students next year.
Oh, and that's why we've got that first year shortage?
Yeah, the first year we provide all the front costs, okay. You know, up front, the district is assuming all the cost. And so that's kind of where we talked about on there, the two and a half year estimated recovery of expenses is that those additional funds go to pay back, you know, essentially the district fund balance in order to recoup
okay.
those costs.
Okay, well, I think you've answered all my questions. Thank you.
Rob, did you have some?
Just quick, and just so I make sure I get my head around this, if the district and a partner agree to where the district would provide a teacher, what happens to the reimbursement for that partner?
So it'd be a different level of reimbursement if the district's providing the instructor, because obviously, so part of the reimbursement, the reimbursement's really twofold. One, it's to reduce the cost to parents, so that's part of it for those 2.5 hours a day. So, you know, if 2.5 hours a day, the parent should have a free 4K experience. And the other part of the reimbursement, because that reimbursement amount, when we tried to look at what different providers were charging weekly rates and daily rates and things like that, that reimbursement amount's higher than what would be equivalent to 2.5 hours a day. It is also to allow them to recover costs associated with potentially a more expensive staff member, a certified staff member, potentially recoup some additional costs associated with overhead and things like that. And so so they may, you know, we haven't talked about it percentage-wise or how the contract will work, but let's say, for example, 9 months out of the year, they're going to reduce $200 a month for parents per kid for the 4K portion. Okay, so 9 months out of the year, that's $1,800 less they would be taking in revenue from their parents. But we'd be providing them with $3,200 of revenue. So that'd be $1,400 more than what they were taking in before. Mm-hmm. And so that extra $1,400 should go to help offset, you know, if they need to pay staff more to get a qualified staff member, or it can go to offset different costs in their programs. You know, as we looked at this, you know, this, yes, there's a definite financial benefit to the district, there's a financial benefit to the parents, there's a financial benefit to the providers as well.
Mr. President, may I make a motion unless someone else?
Yeah, I have one other question. So let's say we approve this tonight, and then we only get 200 kids to sign up. I mean, do we make this contingent upon getting a set number of kids? Or I guess I just want to understand what that math looks like if we get 200, and does it still make it viable at that point in time versus the estimates that we put forth?
Yeah, so the way we work this is we work it based on a per pupil reimbursement and a per pupil basis. So so obviously the fewer the kids, the less we're paying out in reimbursements and things along those lines. I mean, if it gets to a point where it's a loss for the district, then I think we'll have to have a further discussion about it. But so basically, you know, agencies are paid based on the number of students they have in their rooms. It's not a flat amount. We're not saying, we're not saying, okay, you could have 20 kids in there, you're going to get $64,000 for that classroom. That's not what we're paying. If you have, you know, 10 kids in there, you're getting $32,000 because it's based on those 10 kids. We're not going to give $64,000 but only get the funds associated with, you know, 10 kids. So we think the way the funding's set up is that, the funding follows the kids as far as that goes. So it should allow for any, you know, ebb and flow in the amount of kids in the program. But right now, in looking at the numbers and what we're trying to do, we have no reason to believe that this would be a loss for us.
All right.
Mr. President?
Yes.
This is a yes or no. If, back to Jamie's questions earlier, if it's 12 students, it's one teacher. If it's maybe 20, it's two. But is that one certified teacher or two certified teachers?
One.
And then just an aide?
And that, right.
Okay.
That is correct.
Thanks.
Mm-hmm. All right. Mr. President?
Yes.
I'd like to move to allow the district to move forward with a community-based 4K program with final approval of providers and contracts at some point in the future.
All right. So, and just to be clear, you're approving the administration to move forward with implementation of a community-based 4K program for the 2017-18 school year and to seek community partners. Is that
yes,
right?
Yes, with right. approval of providers and contracts in the future.
Okay. That's the motion. Is there a second?
Second.
All right. It's been moved in second, and now it's still up for further discussion as to... Yes, Sandy.
Well, before I vote on this, I just... One of my biggest concerns was that this was going to be paid for by local property taxes. That is not going to happen, obviously.
Correct.
It's not that.
Correct.
So that concern for me is gone. One of my other concerns was I have a really inherent resistance to throwing kids into a public school system earlier than we already do. I think of the Head Start program, which has been proven to the kids level out at about grade 3. When the kids that go into Head Start, which is a government-based program, and they, at about grade 3, they're level with their peers. So I'm not sure the benefit, the educational benefit of this, I haven't been convinced of that. Also, the Hudson High School or the Hudson School District is so, we are so far, we're way up there in the state statistics, and we don't have a 4K program, so we're there without that. I don't know how much better we could get with it, because we're already doing an outstanding job for our students without it. So I got that point, this point, and this point, and I'm going to support this because I want to trust the educators that are telling me this is good for the district, even though I've got some great concerns about it, but I am going to support it because if you're telling me it's what we need, then I'm going to go for it.
I appreciate that.
Mr. President?
Yes, Bruce.
So on top of those comments, which I think are all very good points, you still have an option, right? If you don't want to bring your kid, you don't bring your kid. You don't enroll them if that's something that you don't feel that you want to do. So it's still an option out there. I think in addition to that, we do have good partners in the community, and I am trusting that there are very good conversations that will continue to happen, and that partnership will be strong, and the feedback that we'll be getting on an ongoing basis would be that, you know, we're continually educated at the board level, but also that you feel your voice is being heard in terms of the curriculum and what the kids are going to be offered within your setting, and that it you know, is something that you're excited about and want to participate in it as well. So I think that is very important, at least to me, and I'm sure to a number of others on the board up here, and I know to the administration. So I think it's a great thing for us to move forward with and take a look at, and you know, over time we'll know if our partners are interested and staying engaged, then we're doing a good job. If they're not, then you know, either we're doing something wrong, or maybe we need to listen more and tweak to make it better and provide access for those that want to participate. So I think it's going to be very good for our community.
Other comments?
One final comment. I feel very good about the fact that Sue Helmers is heading up the potential advisory committee that's going to be people from the community. And, you know, I think that says a lot about our effort.
I would just like to add that I thank you for all the work that you guys put into looking into this. And I think one of the keys is, for me, is that this is community-based, as opposed to we're only going to provide this, you know, in school district buildings. I think the fact that this is community-based makes it much more attractive, and I think minimize the impact on, you know, any space issues that could come up. But I don't think doing it, the reason to do it is because, you know, 413 out of 424 are already doing, just because everyone does it. But that's not a sole reason to do it. But it does tell you something. And I think the other telling factor was the fact that of the 413 that have instituted the programs, have there been ones that have adjusted them? Yes. Has there anybody that's backed out completely? No. And there's a reason for that. The other key point, and I'm kind of sensitive to it, I have my own personal story, but I think being able to get the kids in that setting, and if you talk to almost any kindergarten teacher, they'll tell you that you're going to see a better ability to learn generally, not in every single instance, but generally for those that have some type of exposure and a social interaction, those skills. And the thing that I'm most attuned to, and as I said, personal stories, is with all the issues that can be impediments to learning, that ability to see the kids and make those observations and assessments early on, to catch somebody who might have vision issues, as I did when I was 4 years old and was legally blind, they didn't catch it till I was in third grade, or somebody who may have hearing difficulties, or because of the huge increase in autism, and the autism spectrum is huge. And to be able to catch somebody who might be on that, be able to identify that earlier than somebody who wouldn't be able to otherwise afford to send their kids to a private preschool situation. I think if we help just one kid be able to do that, we're doing something great. The fact that we can do this without adding any burden to our local taxpayers. And in fact, doing the math, if the estimated overall cost, and I know it's based on a range of that 150 to 200 FTE and all that, but if $4,100, I can do the math, and $5,700 is what our estimated state aid, that means $1,600 per kid, roughly, is what we're getting. So that's close to, you know, that $480,000 if you use that 300 figure. So even if we don't get 300 kids, if we get 200, well, then we're still going to be coming up ahead $300,000 for our taxpayers. And I agree with Nick that this is an annual deal, and we'll see if we have partners that back out and what's going to do with the numbers. But at the point where this becomes a burden on our local taxpayers, I want to reevaluate that. But short of that, I think that this is one of the things that we can do for our community moving forward without additional costs, and potentially do great things for some individual students who otherwise wouldn't have this opportunity.
Can I just make one other comment?
Yes.
If this were costing the local taxpayers on their property tax bill, I would be an absolute no for this. I would not approve of this. But I want to comment about the community-based facilities we have, too, and they really are outstanding. We are very lucky in Hudson to have such outstanding community-based facilities for our kids that are under school age. So I'm very comfortable with the use of those facilities. I have no questions or qualms about them at all.
I agree. Anyone else have any comments? Otherwise, I'll call the question. All those in favor of the motion moving forward with this program for the 2017-2018 school year, subject to the final contracts being approved, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Those opposed, motion passes. Moving on in the agenda, next up is the 2017-18 calendar year. So if we thought the last subject was at all controversial, how about dealing with the school calendar? But actually, I think this is kind of some good news because, you know, we're doing some great things in the district. And Dave, this follows the heels of a pretty involved school calendar. And I know that Bruce covered this with the last regular meeting. I'd like to hear your input on how the survey and then the decision to pick this calendar over other options.
Sure, and that's a great question. There are definitely elements to the feedback that we received in the survey that found their way into the decision-making process. To be perfectly honest, though, not all of it. And we didn't think this was the right time to make major whole-scale changes to the calendar, given the fact that it's already going through a very significant change. So there were a few things that we asked feedback for that we'll be considering in the next couple years. But there are things such as spring break, time off around holidays and so forth that we received feedback from the calendar survey and included that as best we could in the draft that you're seeing here today. But there were a few elements that it just wasn't the right time. I'll give you an example. That would be the late start, early release sort of structure. It wasn't the right time to take a look at making big changes with that. So the draft that you're looking at here is about 2 weeks earlier than we would typically start, with the Wisconsin law dictating that we start after September 1 unless we receive a waiver. The first day of school would be August 17th, 2017. The last day of school would be May 22nd, 2018. Graduation would be held on Saturday, May 19th, 2018. A couple other notable dates: Thanksgiving break, November 22nd through the 24th, winter break, December 25th through the 29th, and then spring break, March 5th through the 9th, and that still allows for the administration of the ACT both on the primary date and the makeup date. So that's the quick overview of the calendar. Questions about any of the specifics?
Winter break went into January.
Oh, it does. I'm sorry. Yes, it does go into January.
Good catch.
Yep.
Just a couple of points to add to what Dave said. You know, obviously the impetus behind this calendar is the construction that we have going on at the high school. People have often asked us, well, could we start the elementaries early and or start elementaries later and keep the high and just start the high schools earlier or the high school earlier? It creates more issues than it helps. One, it means that we're busing kids for even more days out of the year. Two, if you're a parent that relies on your high school age student or child to take care of your elementary age child, or you're a parent that has elementary age kids that relies on a high school age child from another family to take care of your kids in the summer, provide that care, that can create some real issues. The summer of 2018, what you're going to be getting is probably in the next 3 months we'll be bringing another calendar for you, which is the 18-19 school year calendar, which is going to show a start date that that is going to be probably at least a week after Labor Day. And what that does is it gives us the longest summer we can get the biggest part of our construction done at the high school. There are several parts of the high school project that just cannot be done while kids are in session. That's really the rationale behind the calendar change. It's not because we're, you know, willy-nilly wanting to move things up and back and things along those lines. So that's kind of, we would anticipate that by February you'll have a new another calendar in front of you for the 18-19, get that set and move it forward. But that's where we're sitting.
Mr. President?
Yes.
So no questions, really. We did have quite a interesting discussion on this. It's tough, you know. I mean, it's a lot earlier start. I don't think people are going to be extremely happy about it. But, you know, when we all discussed this and it came down to student safety for us, and having those extra weeks really helps a ton. I don't think there's really an alternative. Of course, there are alternatives, but this is probably the best alternative considering the work that needs to be done and the additional work that can be done without having, you know, potential safety issues. So, I think it's our best shot. You know, I guess one question is, we are going to be coming back with the next calendar pretty quickly, I presume?
Yeah, by February at the latest.
Okay. Which then that would maybe get the latest start time that we would traditionally go for in that particular case. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, no other questions.
I just had one. I'm going to be in favor of this because, you know, I want our summer of 2018 to be as long as possible so that we can get as much done with the remodel at the high school. But just wondering how this works, you know, with the survey that we did and how starting school on January 4th instead of January 2nd, how does that mesh with what, you know, parents and families wanted?
That's a good question. We had a specific question on the survey about the preference to keep the break consistent or to be as short as possible. I don't have the survey right in front of me, but I believe that it tilted toward keep it consistent, which is really what we're doing here.
Mm-hmm. Right. And then how does it impact? Because in the vein of trying to get as many days in the 2018 mm-hmm. summer, I was thinking, well, why do we bring the kids back for the 21st and 22nd? Why don't we just end it on and we gain a weekend to be able to do the remodel and whatnot? But how does that impact, like, finals? Because on the 21st and 22nd, we're not going to have seniors there. And the juniors and sophomores and freshmen, I presume, are going to start their finals the previous week.
Start on Friday.
Right.
Split finals over the weekend.
Yep, exactly. And actually, that gets to your point on January as well. You'll notice that PD day on January 3rd, that's right between the semesters. It actually works out really well with this calendar. That winter break divides the semesters, sort of a college-like schedule. That works out very well. So that first day back on January 3rd, that's when the high school teachers that teach semester-long courses, they're doing a lot of their prep work on that day and a lot of their collaboration to make sure their courses are ready to roll. Mm-hmm.
And this doesn't build in. What happens on snow days?
We hope we don't have any.
Right.
I mean, yeah, we obviously hope that every year, but
that process would be the same. We'd make the decision. Right now, we do have a sufficient number of instructional minutes that we could absorb. At least one, I'm not sure. Mark Cumlin has a pretty complex spreadsheet where he calculates the minutes that are required. There's a different number of minutes required at the secondary level and elementary level, so there's different calculations that go into play. But this doesn't change the total number of minutes, so it would be the same process.
Okay.
Mr. President?
Yes, Sandy.
Can we put something on the website that lets people know right away that this is for this year only, and that next year, well, the other one for 2018 will be up at the same time, right?
No, well, what'll happen is we'll push this thing out. As soon as you hit approve, Tracy's getting ready to send an email message to everybody in the district saying this is the calendar that's been set for next year. Mm-hmm. Are you saying you'd like a portion of that message to say it's 1 year for construction?
I think we need to make some explanation because mm-hmm. people are going to look at this and they are going to go nuts. They're going to think we're doing this every year.
Right.
They need to understand that this is for the construction process only, and this is for this year only.
Yeah.
I think
can you make sure that's in the message?
getting rid of any objections.
So that's already, we already have the design and the message ready to go out.
You're way ahead of me.
Someone might get that in the paper too, I presume.
Yeah. Mr. President.
Yes, Rob.
Hey, Dave, what, yes. And I'm going to show some ignorance, but what is an energy holiday?
So an energy holiday is a day that's designated as a day off where we, no one is in the buildings, the lights are off, we're saving the energy, and it's a day that is built in. We always build it in during that winter break.
Is that a requirement?
It's not a
requirement.
It's been left over. How long have we been doing it, too?
Probably 9 or 10 years, and it's for full-time staff only. So, and it's just, it was one of those things when we were going through the construction of Rivercrest, we looked at energy efficiencies, lead, that type of thing. So it was in conjunction with that. Yeah, well, that too, Dave, yeah.
Right. Can I have one more question?
Yes.
Do you know how much we save by doing that?
You know, Sandy, I think we had a number at one point, but that was several years ago.
I mean, I'm wondering, because our schedule is so bad the next couple of years, is that something we can do away with?
It always takes place Christmas. In between Christmas and New Year's.
Oh, okay.
So long.
All right.
Yeah.
Impact student.
Yep.
Right.
We'd really have a deal if we tried to bring everyone back for that middle day.
I'll make a motion.
We'd have some protesting.
We could try it, though.
No, but can the construction crews be in that day?
What's that?
Will the construction crews be able to be in that day going forward for the next 3 years?
Yeah, I mean, that
so it wouldn't apply to
the construction crews, I mean, they're operating outside of our normal buildings and things like that. But, yeah, and Dave, you may have touched on this already, but Good Friday, is that off or on here?
That is off.
Okay.
Mr. President, make a motion to approve the 2017-18 calendar.
Second. Oh, I said it first. I know.
It doesn't matter.
She's taking it.
I don't care. She can have it.
We'll have a vote over who had the second, but no. Motion by Bruce, second by Sue. Any other discussion? All those in favor say aye.
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 Those opposed? The 17-18 school calendar is approved. Next up is the district leadership compensation structure.
Yep, I'll take that one. This is the same structure that you guys have seen the previous two work sessions. As we told you on the rollout, the ask would be coming at this November's meeting. Just to kind of go through the process a little bit, what this does is it puts a performance component to the salary structure for administrators. We've obviously last year being the first year of the teacher salary structure compensation plan, adding a performance component to the teacher salary structure. The direction was given then to do the same for administrators so that we move away from just blanket raises and that people are getting raises based on performance. This is kind of step two in a three-step process, and then we anticipate eventually moving into classified staff as well. This is a goal-based system, and the reason it's a goal-based system versus a standards-based system for our teaching staff because they're all measured against the same standards. This system is used with a variety of staff, from the directors all the way down to certain folks in food service and buildings and grounds and IT and things along those lines, building principals, deans, system principals, and so the flexibility of this program of this system allows us to be able to do quite a few different job classifications within the same compensation structure, something that we couldn't easily do with a standards-based system. The goal system, just to kind of give you a heads up, we currently are doing goals with our administrative and our leadership teams as a way to I hate to say manage, but you say lead, but as the way to work with each other, we're using a goal-based system, the same system. It's just as of right now, unless the board ties compensation to it, it's a system that will continue to be in place. You know, I would equate it to the TSS system. So we are doing educator effectiveness with the teachers regardless of TSS. And because you've added TSS to it, we're using it within a system that we have. So that's kind of the similar type of thing. We've started this goal-based system. I think it's a goal. It's a good goal-based system. It's something obviously we've talked about with my evaluations and my progress as well. And so, regardless of of passage, we'll still be doing goals with administrators. And these goals are primarily around individual goals and leadership and building capacity in oneself. A lot of our goals in the district are around student achievement, they're around building, they're around process. These goals, we're trying to look at, you know, how they're more impacting individuals as well. And so that's what's so different about this compared to our typical SMART goals that our building sets. So I'm open to answer any questions. I know we've gone through this a couple times, so I don't want to, you know, go through things that you guys may already have a handle on, but I welcome any questions.
Mr. President.
Rob.
What's the budget impact for the 16-17 school year?
I can take that. So we looked at budget impact in a range of everyone attaining one goal, so it would be a 0.4%, and at the top end, everyone attaining three goals. So you'd have a 1.2. So the range of cost is about $15,700 up to $47,000 on the high end.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. President.
Yes, Sue.
Okay. I'm going to not vote for this with a yes. And so I thought about a statement, and so I've written one, and I'd like to just read it, and then it's easier than off the top of my head. The teacher salary schedule, a performance-based tool, is in its second year. That tool evolved out of a grassroots engagement, including teacher leaders, the teacher association, union faculty, as well as administration. In contrast, the proposed lead staff salary schedule for coordinators, supervisors, and administration is a model, in my opinion, endorsed from the top down. At this time, I cannot support approval for the HLSS. I thank Dr. Ouellette and Mr. Gambrill for thoroughly answering my extensive questions at board work sessions and replying to my lengthy emails. I would like to hear more from those directly in positions as coordinators and supervisors regarding what input they contributed to this mechanism. This instrument relies heavily on education speak, with perhaps some esoteric phrases a bit foreign to the ears of our coordinators. Is this evaluative structure something workable at all levels of management?
Can you address, whether it's Nick or Dave or somebody address, because I know that developing some sort of administrative salary structure, but we are calling it Hudson LEAD because it's more than just administrators, but because we also don't like the acronym that creates. So, but we've been talking about this when our previous superintendent introduced the idea of a merit pay based system for teachers, and the focus obviously was to get that going, and that was about a 2-year project before it was even put forward for board review. So just indicate like what was the process? We knew it was going to be coming for administrators and coordinators and supervisors. Has there been any opposition for people to come up with goals in the areas of leadership, culture, and management?
Mr. President, if I could.
Yes.
I haven't spoken much on this topic, but I do want to say that I think the feedback I've been getting from the people I have, two coordinators that I supervise, has been very positive in that it does have an inherent flexibility to it. That it has, that it can adapt to the particular responsibilities of a variety of departments. And you can tailor it to specific needs of that department at that time, which I think is a real asset or a real positive associated with the structure, and will allow us to not have to continuously recreate the wheel, but instead focus on that person's development and leadership in their roles. So I do think that the feedback that's been coming through the pipeline has been very positive about the opportunity to have these goals, have real in-depth conversations and reflections at the outset, but then also looking forward to the continuation of that conversation during the course of the school year. I'm hopeful that it will be a benefit going forward.
Mr. President?
Yes, Bruce.
How many administrators are going to be under this plan?
Well, they're not all administrators. So there's, administrators. It's a loose term. Depends on on their estate report. But we have these would be people that supervise. Supervise others.
So how many supervisors then?
37. Is that right?
37 total employees.
37 or 39? Yeah, somewhere right. Kind of fluctuates, but. Yeah, right in that wheelhouse.
And the amount of teachers that we have?
I don't know,
465?
425.
Yeah, about.
Does that include counselors and specialists and everything else?
I think that's all certified staff, about 425 full-time.
Full-time.
And if I might, I think that's one of the biggest distinctions in terms of the level of feedback. This group that we're talking about, Hudson Lead, we can get them all in this room several times a year and several opportunities to have conversations. You just don't have that luxury with the group of teachers. So the feedback process with teachers and the process for rolling something out to that larger group requires a lot more time, a lot more sort of representative discussion where we have someone that's part of the conversation. They're going back, talking to their stakeholders. With this group, we get them all in the room. We can have that conversation at one time.
Sure. And that's kind of the point, I guess, I was trying to get at. I mean, I think it's great that we're getting a start, right? I mean, even with the TSS, we're looking at the data and we may make edits as we move forward. Shouldn't be any different here, right? I mean, we'll make edits as we move forward. We'll see how it works. Recognizing that this is about leadership and it's about, getting a culture and a group moving forward in the right direction, in the same direction. Being a part of something, being a raider, which is something that we've talked about a lot here and something that we need to be proud about. I'm very supportive of this to move forward and to look at it and to continuously question whether or not we need to make any tweaks as we move forward. Getting a start is important. And in addition to that, leadership is important. And a lot of the aspects that are built into this do focus on leadership. And whether it's leading a football team, leading teachers, or leading people in a business, it's still about leadership. And I think that, this plan carries a lot of that for what we need to do to continue to move forward here. So I'm supportive of it, of the plan. And like every plan, we'll continue to monitor it and see if it's driving the right behavior and actions with that we want to continue to see within this school district.
Mr. President?
Yes, Sandy.
Tim, you said this is going to cost, what was the figure you said?
Well, it ranges approximately $15,000 to
$47,000.
15? Right, 15. 15.
1-5.
Yeah, and so that's it. So the way, just figuring the range very simply is just saying, what if everybody meets goal one? Or one goal, they attain one goal. So that's a 0.4%. So that increases the 15,000.
Okay.
And then on the high end of the range, the most that could be paid out is if everyone attains three goals, and that's how we get the 47.
Okay, and that's irrespective of the percentage increase that the board might give. This is just for the four tenths.
That's just for the performance part of the part of it. Correct.
So that's not too bad. 37 to 39 people involved in this?
Right.
And this would be per year, right?
Mm-hmm. Annually, right.
Okay.
Any other comments?
Oh, one other thing. Sue, so yes. You have an objection with this. Can you share with us what you think would be better? Do you have you done any?
It's the process I'm having trouble with. My interpretation of the process, the TSS went on for about a year and a half, and I know it was a larger body, I'm aware of that, of people. And I like the way that there was very direct input from people at all levels. In this one, I appreciate Andrea's input very much because you are intimate with these people, but like Peggy Eller and so on, it just seemed to me that this model was, I don't see the words in it as being something that was cultivated out of Peg Eller and Jim Siskel and so on. My perception of what was done with TSS was that, you know, it was the people, the grassroots, if you will, that formulated that.
And you feel that's missing here?
I don't see it. And I don't want to drag this out because these wonderful people engaged with me and clarified ad infinitum. So I just thought I would, you know, try to, I know I kept this down to 1 minute because I timed myself.
You're not.
I wouldn't be making a stay here till 8 hours.
You're not dragging it out. I'm just seeking to understand what your objections are. So I appreciate the explanation. Thank you.
Can I add on maybe something that might be helpful? So when we compare the certified staff, the teachers, to this group, we've got to remember that we had a salary schedule in place for decades for teachers. And what happened is that kind of got turned on its head. Then we also had the state effectiveness. So we try to blend those two together. It was a much, much longer process because we essentially, what happened is we went from a very standardized compensation system to something very new. And this one is not that involved. In fact, the people you mentioned, Jim Staskull, Peggy Eller, Mark Cumlin, I've met with each one of those individuals. And what we're doing, we've always had goals and objectives annually. And what we're doing here is just more formalizing these. And so when they're put together, okay. Yeah, well, hopefully that's helpful.
Yeah, we're not changing anything that's being done with the or putting any further demands on supervisors and coordinators. Everyone is expected to come up with a goal or goals, multiple goals, and it's right. Just a matter of whether you attain those. And that's why I support this, is because I think we've been yearning as a board for getting away from just the automatic, everyone gets paid regardless of whether they make their goals or not. And that's what is, I think, good about this system. Is it going to be perfect from the outset? No, maybe not. But the whole point is to start with something. We've been kicking the can down the road long enough. It's time to move forward with something. And the fact that all 37 people have already been on board and created their goals and are moving forward in this direction, I think, says a lot to the leadership for getting this going, so I support it.
Mr. President, just one final comment. What you just said is that this actually is taking place now. It has been implemented without board approval, where the TSS, that didn't start until we had a thorough discussion of it and then approved it. So I'm not having any trouble with the concept of us moving to a performance base for this level, not at all. I think it's great. I don't like this model because to me it's not something that came from the ground up. It just was plopped on everyone, except Andrea has given supportive evidence that coordinators and directors level people seem to be comfortable with it. So
just a point of clarity, this is not implemented without board approval.
Yeah.
The goal-based system is more of a leadership style and how I have, you know, what I brought in with the team and how I want the team to lead and how I want them to evaluate themselves and each other. Regardless of whether or not you approve a pay structure tied to it. So similar to educator effectiveness, we often have the time, or often when Andrea says, is anybody wanting to opt out of TSS? They will say, well, we want to opt out of educator effectiveness, and we remind them that educator effectiveness is happening regardless of TSS. The TSS is just the pay component on top of educator effectiveness. So, you know, the goal-based system is something that that I've wanted to implement with the leadership staff. The way that the pay structure sits with it and how the goals are developed was the collaborative nature of what we're doing. And that's the part that would still need, obviously, board approval, but we'll continue to set personal goals around these three areas as just a function of leadership within the district in how we operate.
Mr. President?
Yes.
I will move to approve the district leadership compensation structure.
Second. Motion by Bruce, second by Rob. Is there any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
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 Those opposed?
Nay.
The motion passes, and the district leadership compensation structure is approved as recommended. Next, I will entertain a motion pursuant to the language in the agenda.
Mr. President, motion to adjourn into closed session pursuant to Wisconsin Statutes 19.85, Parent 1, Parent C, to discuss the employment and or resignation of professional staff members.
Second.
Okay. Motion by Bruce, second by Carrie. This requires a roll call vote. Thank you. Start with Carrie.
Whitaker, aye.
Gerke, aye.
Johnson, aye.
Hanson, aye.
Brown, aye.
Katas, aye.
We are adjourned to closed session.